Welcome to Behind the Scenes for the Breedlove Way. I am Chris Breedlove. I am a United Church of Christ minister. I pastor in Los Altos, California at Foothills Congregational Church. That's my day gig. And I decided that what we need in 2020 is another podcast. But I have some wonderful people for you to meet on these podcasts. And today's special guest is Deanna Wolf. And she is doing some incredible, inspiring, significant, important work for UniteTheParks.org. She is the executive director for that organization. And that organization is working to preserve a swath of land between Yosemite and the Sierra and Sequoia National Parks. And this is very important because what we will learn in today's podcast is that there are some endangered species that need protection. In fact, one specific species that we talk about is the Pacific fisher. There could possibly be only a couple hundred of these animals left. And so in our lifetime, we could lose this animal. And so it's right in our backyard, a place that some of our friends and family, we all know in California, nationwide, it's a treasure, this Sierra mountain range. And this work is really important. And so we learn about UniteTheParks.org and the scope of that work. We learn about the Pacific fisher in this podcast. And we also learn about Deanna Wolf. She is an award-winning author, and I'm borrowing some of this bio intro from Unite the Parks, so thank you for that. She's an advocate with a deep love and commitment for the Sierra Nevada mountain range. For 20 years, more than 20 years, she's been project manager and editor in organizing complex and highly technical projects on a diverse set of topics. While working as a consultant, she explored vast portions of the West and the world, developing comprehensive understanding of the American landscape. She has been a ranger, park ranger, a river guide, a yoga instructor. Her outdoor experience, organizational skills, adaptability laid the groundwork for her role as the founder executive director of Unite the Parks. And so thank you for tuning in. And at the end of this video, like and subscribe all the links that we give you. Share this widely on your social media platforms. And most importantly, chip in your nickels and dimes, because all of us working together can save the Pacific fisher, can make a difference in our lifetime, a significant difference in working to protect this, the Range of Light National Monument. So thank you for tuning in, and we hope to see you again when we do some more interviews.
Well, it's great to talk to you, and so we'll just jump in. I have an introduction I'll do before this that'll be okay. Formal. But I was really excited about, of course, your Ralph Waldo Emerson quote that's a tagline on one of your introductions, and no doubt that you would choose Emerson. The enthusiasm quote. Enthusiasm is the mother of effort, and without it, nothing great was ever achieved.
Yeah.
And I thought about that in concert to your advocacy, and because, yeah, you know, so much of your work, your advocacy is facing this, what seems to be runaway climate change, and how disheartening this is, and urgent this is, and yet you've, yeah, balanced your work with enthusiasm. Which I think if you don't do, right, you would burn out otherwise. I mean, it's just too much.
Right. That's right.
Yeah, talk about that word enthusiasm, because, you know, as I shared with you, that, you know, some of the Greek background and even Latin background means to be impassioned with the Spirit of God, or some kind of rendering like that. Yeah. Is there a spiritual basis or energy to your advocacy work?
Definitely, definitely. So there's sort of two questions there. So I'm going to separate them out. And I would say that enthusiasm is really important, because when you're trying to do something difficult, you're going to have a lot of tough days. So you need to keep getting up and trying again and again and again. And you build strength when you do that. But having a positive attitude, I know that's kind of a generic statement, but it's very helpful, right? And that, of course, comes from the sort of the second part of your question, you know, which is, you know, where is this coming from in the first place, right? Like, you don't just like wake up and decide that you're going to create a national monument and spend a bunch of time on something like that. And that comes from experience, and then, you know, love and spirituality. So those are kind of the three things that, and those, the experiences are really the story behind, you know, how I got started on this. So, you know, I can tell you a story that's the beginning of it.
Oh, no, please do. Yeah, tell a story.
Okay. Well, first, I mean, I definitely did not think that I would be on this path at all. It's very surprising to me. I'm from like the suburbs of Cupertino, and I was very, you know, spent a lot of time on my appearance and had a lot of outfits, and, you know, I got most likely to make a million, and I was like, my goal in life was I'm going to make a lot of money. But this changed. And a lot of it has to do with some of the experiences I had up in the mountains. And so I wanted to go to graduate school, and my parents were like, okay, if you're going to get a degree in literature, you have to pay for that yourself. Cause that's what, you know, they were like, that's, we don't respect that degree. I mean, they're supportive, but they were like, you're paying for that. So I got a job as a waitress at Tenaya Lodge, which is a place just outside Yosemite.
Right.
And it's very close to the area that I'm trying to protect. So I didn't really think much of this summer. I just thought that's how I'm going to pay for school. And I rented a room from a couple. I didn't know very much about this couple, and they had issues with drugs and alcohol. Again, I didn't know this. And there was a bit of a domestic violence problem as well. So it starts out terribly, right? So I came home one day after hiking, and, you know, he had threatened to murder her. I mean, this is terrible, right?
Yes.
And the police had been called, and he had driven his car into her friend's vehicle. And so it was absolute mayhem. And I was like, okay, I have to leave. I'm not safe here, right? So, I didn't have any place to go, though. This was a problem. And I also didn't really know anyone there, but I knew that you could pitch a tent in the woods.
Yeah.
So I did that. And I, you know, this was not on my list of things to do at all. I didn't think this was fun. I was really afraid of the dark. And so I just kept my things in a locker at work, and I would work at night, and then I would drive down this dark dirt road to this little flimsy nylon contraption, which was my home. And it was just like, I was afraid. So I had weapons, and I was like, I have a cooking pot. I mean,
like a baseball bat, nunchucks.
Well, no, no, I had a cooking pot, and I had laundry.
Oh, wow.
I would use bleach for bleaching my shirts white for work. But anyway, that's all I had. So I was like, if someone comes by, I'll just hit them with the pot and I'll throw bleach in his eyes. That'll be it. But instead, of course, I didn't have this terrible experience. You know, instead of this kind of nightmarish thing, you know, I would wake up every day with the sun and the birds singing and, you know, the chipmunks running around and the smell of pine and the sounds of water. And, you know, it was beautiful. And it was the opposite of that. It was really good. And in a month of being outside all the time, in this beautiful place, I felt amazing. Like, I felt so good that it was like, I don't even have words to describe the way it felt. And so connected to the world around me in a way that I didn't know it was possible. So this really, altered me, this experience. And, I thought, well, this is something worth getting to know, you know, nature is amazing. And the sense of sort of the spirituality is really your sense that you're connected with all the other living things on the planet. You know, it's just the way it feels. So it's very hard to describe.
That's well said. You know, growing up in the suburbs of Cupertino, and then having later in life these experiences in wilderness, do you think, especially park rangers, one of the gigs you've had before, river guide, yoga, did you think for those that don't grow up with that opportunity to get out into nature, do you think that fear of the wilderness is something that they have to overcome, and just like you had to overcome and reorient yourself?
Yeah, I think so. I think it's really helpful if you get introduced, you know. I mean, the my parents took me hiking when I was a little girl, because we, you know, we didn't have very much money. So we'd go up and we'd go hiking in Sequoia National Park. So that was our place. So that's why I thought the idea of working as a waitress to pay for school up in the mountains would be great. I just didn't expect the other part of it.
Oh, yes. Yeah, right.
The drama.
The part where I was human drama. Living. Yeah.
That was not on my list.
No.
But if it wasn't for my... you know, the exposure from my parents, you know, then I think I wouldn't have been there at all. Right. And, you know, like my father is from Fresno and he got introduced to the parks via the Boy Scouts. Right. So it's helpful if you can have somebody introduced to you. Yeah.
That's such a wonderful work for people that do introduce, because usually they're people that have experienced a healing aspect of the wilderness, such as yourself, a rejuvenation, recreation, recreation is what we call it. So you're right. We all need somebody to introduce us again to what should be innate in us, but it's hard to awaken to that. You know, enthusiasm too strikes me as a really important quality as a leader, especially in this kind of advocacy for nonprofit kind of work. You know, your enthusiasm, I can tell, serves you well. But you're trying to generate some enthusiasm with this campaign, Unite the Parks. And so I'm assuming that this wonderful namesake for Unite the Parks comes from this land between Yosemite and Kings Canyon. And having spent some time in Fresno myself, I pastored a wonderful church there and worked with in a wonderful interfaith community. You know, Fresno just has, as you know, so many capable people and people that are just salt of the earth. And one of my favorite things to do to recreate myself after doing, you know, advocacy work and ministry would be to go to the wilderness. And so I spent a lot of time in that area, not really knowing the various things at play. And sadly, not knowing about the Pacific Fisher, who I hope we will talk about in just a moment.
Yeah.
But let's talk about the Range of Light campaign before I get ahead of myself. Well, first of all, how old is Unite the Parks? How old is this effort?
Okay. Well, the effort to make the Range of Light National Monument started in 2013. So it's about 7 years old at this point. So I've been working on it for a long time, but you know, the organization Unite the Parks is from 2017. And that's just because after you dedicate a certain amount of time to something, you sort of have to build the organization underneath it to keep it going. And so that's Unite the Parks, right? And Unite the Parks is because yes, there's Yosemite here and you've got Sequoia Kings Canyon here and there's the missing piece in the center. We want to protect that part. So Unite the Parks.
Yes.
And the name. So, So, I mean, there's the two parts to the enthusiasm, right? I think you have to have a great love for something beyond yourself, right? But to try to get a whole bunch of people to step in the same direction and protect nature, you know, that's going to be really hard. Right. I mean, it's not like somebody's just going to say, well, that's a good idea. Let's just do this. Right. There's going to be a lot of forces that are going to show up and push the other direction.
Yeah,
right.
Right.
So the other part of this that, you know, gives me a lot of energy is that I had my great summer, which was, you know, the surprise. And I didn't immediately go, oh, I'm going to protect this place. What I did is I got really excited by nature and I thought, I'm going to go all over the West and I'm going to go all over the world and I'm going to explore it. And I would just, that's the jobs that I had, like the river guide, the ranger. And what I was also doing, which is kind of negative, is that I was kind of like, you know, there's all these problems in California. It's crowded, it's expensive, there's pollution everywhere. And I want to go someplace else, right? That doesn't have, someplace it's just like California, but without the problems, right?
Yeah, where is this utopia?
Mm-hmm. Well, what I discovered, it's no place, which is what utopia means, right? Mm-hmm. What I discovered is that I keep coming back to the Sierra and this area and thinking, God, this place is amazing. You know, there's just nothing that beats this place. And it just kept getting reinforced. And, you know, eventually I was like, you know, you watch it decline and starts to bother you. And, and I'm like, you know, this is something that I am responsible for as well. And so the learning to turn around and recognize that that there's a part of me that needs to change, right? Which is like, you know, you do want to go someplace else. You want to get away from your trouble, but you know, it's not going to go away.
Right.
So then you have to turn toward it and then take it on. So that took a long time and a lot of, you know, maturity, but it was a slow process.
Well, so. Maturity usually is a slow, methodical journey. Right. And, you know, you talked about this a bit of a spiritual awakening in this environment, in this very wonderful wilderness environment, and realizing the interconnectedness of you and this wilderness. And as you see that decline, you do feel it in your own soul.
You feel terrible, basically.
Yeah.
So there's two things. You want to stop the you know, the decline, and then you also want to get. You want to give other people this opportunity to have a really great experience as well. I mean, when you have a great experience, I think it's natural to sort of wish others to have it.
Right.
So they can have their moment where they're out in the woods and are like, this is amazing.
Yes.
So I would be super delighted if, you know, millions of people have that experience in the future. But first, we have to make sure it's protected so that there's something there for them to enjoy. So, that's the work, right?
That's one reason why I'm very excited to encourage people to support this campaign and also, you know, to chip in, you know, when I can, because it's one of these rare opportunities where we have a metric for success. Yeah. You know, we have a very specific goal with what Unite the Parks has put together and everybody working on the Range of Light campaign, all the partners. You know, it comes with your great enthusiasm and leadership to define what these things are. It seems to be, you know, if we can watch and the Pacific fisher thrive, be protected, then we can say, oh, here is something we are moving the needle. We're actually making a difference. And it seems that for activism and people getting involved in all these online petitions, you know, that we do. This seems like something we can really watch and measure. And we know that people like you are behind it.
Right. Well, the Pacific fisher is an interesting case, right? So to go with, to make the Range of Light National Monument, you have to have a bill, and the bill has to pass in Congress. And as you know, those kinds of things are pretty difficult. Now they may, hopefully in January, things will start to look brighter. Okay. But
yes, right.
But it takes a lot of work to put the energy behind something like that happening, which would be a big change for this area, right? So that's legislation. So, but litigation. So the lawsuit has to do with the Endangered Species Act, and that's a different thing, right? And it is potentially. I mean, there's still a ton of work. You have to win your case. There's all these things that have to happen. But the fisher in exploring this area and also like looking at the maps, I'm like, wait, the Pacific fisher lives in all the areas that are unprotected, basically, like where the big trees are. It lives like between, you know, basically between 2000 and about 7,000 feet is kind of its range, right? And those are the areas that are not protected, which it needs to be protected. So if we're able to get these areas protected in the name of the fisher, which is right here, this is the Pacific.
It looks like a cross between a bear and an Ewok.
Yeah, it's so cute. It's like the cutest animal. Thankfully, that's helpful to us. So if we can protect the landscape in the name of the fisher, we should basically be able to halt all of the commercial logging that's going on there. Which leads to decline in habitat. And that's not just for the fisher, but for like all the other species that live there.
Right.
And also that would, you know, lead to a landscape that is also less likely to burn. Because right now there's all those fires, but a lot of that, the fires are tied to, you know, the extractive industries and logging. Mm-hmm. So it's not really commonly understood, but you know, if you look at the maps right now, you see where the big fires were this summer. They're not in our parks.
Mm.
They're in the forests, and they're in the forest for a number of reasons. But the correlation is between logging and fire. So you have logging, you have more fires and more severe fires and more frequent. So that's, we don't like that, right?
Is that a controversial thing to say? I would imagine with the powers at play, lobbyist, sure. You know, logging lobbyist interest.
Well, I think it depends on who you're talking to. Mm-hmm. So if you're talking to a scientist who studied the landscape, they will agree. I mean, there's just not even, you're not going to get any pushback on that, right? I think people who have taken part in logging, you know, if you're saying to them that logging is correlated with fire, I mean, you're putting them in a position that is pointing a finger at them, right? And that's not going to make them feel very good. And so, and that's not really the goal, right? Because I don't want to make somebody feel bad, right? That's not, but I do understand that there's going to be defensiveness and there's a desire to have the logging be positive, right? Particularly if it was your career.
Right.
So you know, when we wave our fingers and say logging is bad, logging causes fires, you know, everybody who's involved in that industry is on the defensive. And there's not, unfortunately, there's not much I can do about that. You know, I wish that I could say that it was okay, but it's really ultimately not.
You know, you do mention the website, Unite the Parks. One of the benefits, the economic benefits to uniting the parks would create this wonderful economy. And I don't know about you, you know, when I've been to Yosemite before Corona, you know, at certain parts of the park, it's overwhelmed with tourists and you know, they have mitigation plans and ways to bus people into the park and central parking lots, but it's still quite a, you know, I don't want to say exploitation of the natural wilderness, but it's a burden. It's an incredible burden on the human and the natural setting alike. And so it seems like I always enjoyed going to Kings Canyon or Sequoia because it seemed, seemed a little bit more accessible, not as populated. But there's this ecosystem that doesn't know park boundaries, you know, and what's it's this swath of land, the range of light. Where does that name come from, the range of light?
Well, it has an interesting history. Let me just address the economic.
Sorry, I'm so excited to talk to you. I'm jumping everywhere.
Well, that's okay. There's just two separate things that I want to address them separately because they're both really important, right? And one is the economic issue and tourism, right? So you know that Yosemite, which is half the size of our proposed monument at this point, employs basically five times as many people as the Forest Service does. Like, so basically the Sierra National Forest versus Yosemite, you've got way more people employed just by the park, not even looking at recreation. It just takes a lot more people to manage people, right? So you're already going to put a lot of people to work just by that, not including the recreation and tourism. So we know there's way more jobs associated with protection. So that's good. The other thing, which, you know, we want to put people to work, you know, the other thing is that because the proposed monument is slightly different than, you know, it will be different than a park, there's an opportunity for dispersal, meaning an issue with Yosemite is you have these three highways, right? And they all converge into this valley. And so it's really hard to control the impact of that. Plus Yosemite Valley is extraordinary, right? I mean, I love the Sierra and I have like thousands of favorites, which renders favorite a word that doesn't matter, but the valley is pretty amazing and people want to go there. And so you have a problem, right? Which is the concentration of all those people into this tight spot. And there really isn't, it's hard to imagine how they can manage it. They're doing their best, you know, they have buses and so forth, but it's just a challenge.
Yeah.
But we don't have to have the same issue outside of Yosemite Valley. You know, we can disperse people, have them go different places. keep some dirt roads that are interesting for people with four-wheel drive vehicles. I mean, there's all kinds of ways to manage it differently so that it, you can still have your little quiet spot to picnic, right? So there's that. So you have more jobs, a different kind of recreation, and then dispersals, so that it's not like you're going to get overwhelmed with everyone in one spot. Like, we really don't want that. Or I don't want that. So there's that. In terms of the Range of Light National Monument, or the Range of Light idea, it comes from John Muir. So now John Muir, I think, is an amazing person. There are people that look at him critically, and I understand that, you know, he's an imperfect person, but he did enable us to have these two big parks, which is Yosemite and Sequoia, for which I am really grateful. Mm-hmm. I mean, I go to those parks and I'm like, this is amazing. Thank you. Thank you for this being here. But when he rode over Pacheco Pass, which is mm-hmm. Highway 152, of course he was on a horse, right? But he describes the Range of Light in really glittering terms. He describes the Sierra Nevada snowy range. He goes into this long extended description of how beautiful it is and identifies it as the Range of Light. And if you pull out your map and you look at, you know, here's Pacheco Pass, and then you draw a line directly east, you know, you will be looking at the National Monument, or the proposed National Monument. And so I just thought, well, not only is it's a beautiful and poetic phrase, but it's also quite appropriate because, you know, that's how he was describing it. So as the Range of Light. Hopefully, it will be called that in the future. We'll see.
Well, I hope too. People will get excited because this is something, you know, even here in Los Altos, near Cupertino, yeah. where you grew up, you know, this yeah. is something not terribly far away for us no. as well. I mean, it's just a real treasure for the country and for yeah. Californians in particular. And, you know, for yeah. Californians that really pride themselves in being, you know, a progressive state in so many ways. I think yeah. that once people, you know, really learn that this specific need is in our backyard, our stewardship, I'm yeah. hoping that people will join you in your enthusiasm
yeah.
in protecting the Range of Light. The Pacific yeah. Fisher, is that a picture that you had a chance to take, or is that because there's only what, a few hundred of them is what I was reading at one site.
The number of fishers in existence is very low. Yeah. And they're also, you know, they're skittish, really. You're not going to see them. And I've probably only seen one running across the road away from me. And I think it was a fisher, but I'm not sure. So they're hard to see, and there's not that many of them. So the situation with the Pacific fisher is dire, right? So it was listed as endangered. That is not a good sign. The agency had to be, so the Fish and Wildlife Service, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, is in charge of doing these listings, right? They had to be sued to list the animal in the first place. So some groups came along, sued them, and they said, okay, well, we'll list it as endangered. So there's that. So now the status is that last count, there were approximately 250 of the animals.
Wow.
Not very many, right?
No.
That count also is before, you know, we had the drought and the beetle kill, and then before these big fires. And so we're really alarmed by the situation. And the agency, the way that it works is there's the listing, and then the Endangered Species Act basically sets this up such that the Forest Service will then go to the Fish and Wildlife Service and say, hey, we want to do this logging, and they have kind of a negotiation. And then the Fish and Wildlife Service issues what's called a biological opinion, which is a statement on a piece of paper that says, you may do X, Y, and Z. So after the listing, the agency said, you know, you have 40 logging projects, you know, go ahead, and gave them a take permit. And a take permit means that they can hurt, maim, or kill Pacific fishers as part of those projects. And so they gave them permission to kill 12. Now, there's just not that many of them, right?
Yeah, so, that's an enormous percentage when you're only talking about a few hundred or a couple hundred.
Right, and we don't even know if there are a few hundred.
You were hoping, right.
Because the count was before the drought, before the beetle kill, before the fire. So this is where the lawsuit comes into play, because to get the agency to do their job, you have to sue them. Unfortunately.
Yeah. Right.
So that's where we're at. We're working on that right now. And we'll see. Hopefully it'll go well.
Well, you know, that I can see the pain in your heart when you talk about that. And I can really, sympathize, with that too. It's just a very heavy reality that we could be the last generation to see this species, And so I hope people that are having a chance to watch this will follow all the links that we share, for you at the parks and the campaign and really get excited about showing up for this little critter. I don't know, this wonderful species. But there are other cousins to this species, right? There are other animal cousins, like 92 other endangered animals that live in this swamp land too.
Yeah, there definitely are. There's first off, in the Sierra Nevada, like, it's important to take a step back and like realize what it is. So there's my just innate love for it, which is based on passion. I just like it there. There's no reason. It's beautiful. You go to Yosemite Valley and you're overwhelmed, but there's no reason for that. But anyway, there are 3,000 species of plants in the Sierra Nevada, and a good portion of them don't grow anywhere else on Earth. So hundreds don't grow anywhere else, like the giant Sequoia, which is an amazing tree that most people are familiar with because it's like a prehistoric dinosaur of a tree, right? Thousands of years old. And then there's all the little animals that run around the forest as well that are not doing very well. The Pacific fisher is one, but you've got the marten, and the Sierra Nevada red fox, the great gray owl. I mean, just the list goes on. Like, the number of species that are endangered or threatened on some level of watch list is really high. So, we're not talking about even fish. I mean, there's fish that are endangered, so on and on, and it starts to be really dark sounding. It is kind of dark, right?
Well, yeah, which makes it a very, in my hearing of the urgency, makes it a very sacred undertaking.
Yeah, so the thing with the fisher is that if we're able to be successful, it's not just about the fisher, right? It's about all the other species that are in this area. So hopefully, with the fisher, we can save a whole bunch of species and also, make another step towards getting this area protected and set aside for wildlife and people, so it's also a nice place to go. Right.
Right.
It's really pretty unpleasant to go up to the mountains and see the trees being logged. Yeah, I would say that's my least favorite thing to do. And I unfortunately, do that in, for the projects, go up there and survey, but, it generally makes me unhappy. So
I can imagine, and me too. And like you said earlier, I thought you were so compassionate and understanding that there's a whole industry of livelihood for people who do this, and yet we are interconnected with this creation. If we don't take care of this this environment, we are a part of the environment, and therefore That's we right. neglect ourselves. And our kids don't get to grow up with this wonderful animal, this species, so many other species in jeopardy.
That's right.
Yeah.
Well, I think there's a lot of people up in the mountain region. So the first 2 years of my campaign, I would just drive up to the mountains and go door to door with my clipboard, which was really awkward for me. There's a number of reasons I've never done it before. I'm asking people to sign on to a petition to protect a large landscape. And it's just a huge ask, right? And, you know, they always wanted to know why I was doing it, which mean I had to tell them my story, which was not something I wanted to tell people. I was like, that just kind of puts me in the zone of out there. So, but, you know, it's what happened. And so there's a reason I'm telling you this story, because instead of having this really terrible experience with doing that, I really made friends up there, and it was a wonderful experience, actually. And people invited me over to their house and cooked me dinner. And it was like the opposite of what I expected, which was that I'm like, I'm going to get run out of town and shot. But this is not what happened. So I feel that, you know, these people saved me.
Yeah.
And I want to give them something of value, and they may disagree with what it is I want to give them, but I know it's of value, and I know there'll be a lot of jobs, and it may not be cutting trees down. It might be building trails, right? But it's a job, and it's a job that will last. And it also provides a future for the area, because the lawsuit would stop the logging, and that's great. But you have to do the next thing, which is to provide jobs. And that's where the monument comes into play, and it becomes really important, which is a future that looks really positive and has, you know, people recreating the world around them in a positive way. So, I mean, it's all of that together. I think you want to do both of those things. It's important. So anyway.
Well, this is, you talked about the number of years you've been working on this. This is a significant part of your life's work. And for those that are joining onto this campaign, what a noble endeavor. And so thank you to all those people that have paved the way long before I knew about this. I'm very grateful for those folks that have brought attention to this. And now the people that are learning about it, you know, as we need this kind of, you know, real strong push, it sounds like.
Yeah. I mean, every person helps. It's, you know, I have really good friends that have been there for me. You know, there's times when it's really tough, right? And you have to do things that are uncomfortable, like grassroots campaigning was very uncomfortable for me. But then there was a whole period of time where, you know, I was giving speeches, and I mean, to give a speech made me so nervous. You know, I'd have to practice the speech like 100 times. And then I'm like, okay, I think I'll be fine. You know? And I mean, I'm okay with it.
Are you a bit of a perfectionist?
Sure, but it's, you know, what you're afraid of is you're going to forget, and then everybody's going to be staring at you, and you're going to be like, have no words, right? So it was less about perfectionism and more about, although I do care about what I say, it's just that, it was more that I was afraid that I would just go blank. I didn't have any experience to know that you'll be fine. Don't worry about it. You know, but I had friends that I could call that would be supportive of me. And so, you know, and my family is kind to me. So, you know, what I'm trying to say is that everyone goes through this in their life. There's the struggles, right? Mm-hmm. And when we can call up a friend and talk to them about it, it just makes it better. Like, it's just somehow easier. So anytime a person is providing you with something supportive, even if it's just a text message, it's really wonderful. Like, it makes your day better, right? So, you know, I hope that we can support each other. Especially right now. I think this is a tough time for everyone.
Yeah, you're right. We need positive things, I think, to rally together during this pandemic that, you know, we've never lived through. Our parents have never lived through.
Yes.
Everybody experiencing this, we haven't experienced anything quite like this. And so I think we do need some positive things, that important things that we can work together with. Right.
Right.
And this is one of these things that I get really excited about as a community organizer, that the things that I usually get involved with are not partisan issues. They're mostly common sense issues.
Right.
And who would not want to help preserve, you know, this Pacific fisher? Who would not want to help preserve this land for our future generations, our children, our children's children? It cuts across this polarized partisan times that we have been living in. It's not just a recent occurrence, right? And we just need things like that that bring us together, that we can really feel good about.
Well, I agree with that. These things are good, and they should bring us together. And there are very positive, and definitely when you talk about, when you mention Yosemite to people, or you mention Sequoia Kings Canyon, they have all these memories that are triggered, you know, of the wonderful times they had in the parks. And then you say, let's make another one. And it's like, yes, that's a good idea. Let's do that. So it seems like that would be really easy. Okay. But
no,
it's not that, I mean, it is a political issue. You do have a divide between the two parties, unfortunately. I mean, not all of them, you know, there's not all Republicans are against conservation. Mm-hmm. It's just, that's the trend. And so it's disappointing because all of us, whether we're Democrat or Republican, can appreciate Yosemite Valley. And I'm pretty sure there's Republicans that go there.
Oh, yeah.
And have a good time. So, you know, I think it would be great if that party would start thinking a little bit more about contribution, about giving something back to future generations and starting to restore them, so that, you know, we're giving a gift to people we won't even meet, and they'll never be able to thank us, but they will be sitting sometime under a tree and feeling really great, you know? So, I mean, right. So I don't think this idea of giving forward is, it should be restricted to one party or another, right?
Right.
It shouldn't be that way. But for some reason, when you talk environment, it starts to get divided pretty quickly.
Right.
Unfortunately.
Well, I'm a big fan of putting conservation back in conservative, you know, ideologies or conservative efforts. I think conservation is, you know, that's a part of where that word comes from. Thinking about talking with you, I was thinking about this interview between Bill Moyers and Jane Goodall in 2009, December. And I think I sent you this script. Do you want to role play this script? I'll be a very underwhelming Bill Moyers, and you can be Jane Goodall.
You want me to read her part?
Oh, yeah. We'll pretend like I'll pretend like I'm Bill Moyers reading this part, and then you be Jane Goodall. Because I think it's a really powerful thing. Let's try it. Be brave.
Okay.
Throw caution to the wind. Here we go.
Okay.
Here, let me put on my Bill Moyer face. I aspire to be half of what Bill Moyers is. You have something that I know a lot of people admire. You once said that you have the peace of the forest in you. What is that?
I think what you know, being out there in the forest all those months alone, there was a growing sense of this great spiritual power all around, something greater than me. So you could lie and look up at the stars and feel yourself tiny, and yet somehow having this extraordinary awareness that we have as human beings, as you know, we can encompass a vague sort of feeling of what the universe is. And all in this funny little brain here. So there has to be something more than just the brain. It has to be something to do with spirit as well.
Very good. I think that's Oscar caliber performance there. I think that'll helm the Oscar or the Emmy. So this great spiritual power all around, you know, that's the part of Jane Goodall that really made me think, well, gosh, you know, Deanna has this in spades. She has this sense of the environment she's striving to protect. It's something more than a career aspiration. It's something more than you know, just a stubborn, obstinate conviction. This is ingrained in your being. You could not help but do this and be this.
That's right. That's exactly right. You know, it's hard work, right? And I love to do it. But, you know, there's definitely challenging days, but I can't not do it. Like, I have to do this. It's a very, I guess conviction is what it is. And it is coming from that sense of spirituality where, you know, there was this day, you know, where I was out in the mountains and just nothing was going on. I was just walking through the forest, you know, I wasn't in Yosemite. It was just a pretty forest. And I remember just feeling like, I don't know how to say it, just absolutely connected to the living things that were around me. And just the sense that we were one, you know, and it was the best feeling ever. I don't know. And I just thought, why? Of course you want to protect something like that. And you want to make sure that it thrives.
Right.
It's totally beyond you. It's there. You know, you're together. And, you want others to have the feeling, even if it's just for a day.
Well, so, it's healing too, you know, to have that kind of baptism is rejuvenating, centering. You know, I think in Japanese culture, if you go to some doctors there, I think the good doctors, and they detect that you're struggling with depression, of course, they care about medication. They care about all the things that doctors everywhere care about. But then from time to time, what they'll write down on the prescription is go bathe in the forest. Down nature bathing, right? And as your RX, you go out to the forest, you spend time. And it really is. I like to, we have a little shout park not too far from the church. It's a grove of trees. I'll go there and I'll sit by the little runoff creek when it's running, and I'll just throw a little twig and I'll watch it float down there and I'll meditate to that. But you just feel the ground beneath you. You feel the canopy shade of the trees above you. The humming of birds, fluttering of butterflies. There's life all around you. And that life, as you can tell, I'm a big fan of the spirituality of nature as well.
Yeah. Well, it's really powerful. And, you know, for me, I felt like I just kind of stumbled upon this. You know, it completely overwhelmed me, though. It was like I stumbled into this and I was like, this is the best thing I know. This blows every experience I've ever had away. And it's just nature. Like, why didn't anyone tell me that it was going to be this great? I would have been here sooner, right? So, I mean, it just really altered me in terms of the way that I chose to spend my time. And then there's the rest of it. But no, it's just so much better. I mean, now I'm really aware of what it does for you, you know, like intellectually aware that, you know, if I'm not feeling good or I'm having a bad day or trying to figure something out, you know, just go hike up a hill and you'll feel better. And you'll probably have sorted out whatever it is you need to do, or however, you know, you need to process a thought. You're going to have it sort of sorted out at the end of that. Right. So, I mean, there's a lot there. And then just the enjoyment of being alive, right? There's the part that it helps you function in society, right? But then just being connected, you know, is and relaxing outside is wonderful. So
yeah, it does enliven you. It really does spark that. I want to go over the goals of the, you know, protecting the Pacific Fisher and the Southern Sierra Nevada, so that your five goals, I think, and then I'll let you interject, you know, some thoughts in between. So I'll just read them as we go along because it's, you know, educational for me to already know all these goals. So for our viewers to build congressional support for the Range of Light National Monument Bill.
Yeah,
we already have 21 members of the House in support. Is that number have potential to increase if we advocate to our representatives to?
I think your representative is probably Anna Eshoo. Am I correct?
Yes. Yeah.
Yes. And she's already a supporter.
Right. So. Well, okay. So in that case, if for viewers that if that too is your representative, then write her a thank you.
Yeah.
Let her know that was a good choice.
Yes. She's great. And the thing that we need is a congressional advocate. And I should explain what that is, because basically we have all these support letters, but we need someone to carry a bill for us, which means the bill is introduced. Now, there's introducing a bill and then there's actually getting a bill to pass. But to set up a national monument, so this is technical, but it's important. National monuments can happen one of two ways. You can have a bill that passes both House of Congress, or you can have a presidential proclamation. Now, ideally, you want a bill because it sticks. It's a more powerful part of the Antiquities Act. But as a backup, you want, you know, you have a president that wants to leave a legacy, and you could go the route where he does it. Now, to do that, this is where we're circling back to a legislative advocate. You need a congressperson that will at least introduce a bill. Just introduce it. They don't have to do anything other than, you know, drop it in the hopper. So we need a congressperson who will help us with that. So if it's Anna Eshoo, you know, great.
Yeah, we need a champion. We need a champion, yes, to help carry us across the goal line. Every right. legislation that passes has a champion.
That's right.
I think she would be up for it.
Well, I hope so. I really like her staff, but you know, they're very busy, so they would somehow have to get some extra motivation. Mm-hmm. So hint.
Yes. Well, they'll see everybody piling onto this campaign and they'll say, okay, here's something we need to get with too.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. That's right. Well, if they hear from constituents, it's actually really important.
Yes, it is.
It's way more important that they hear from constituents than from me, you know. So that would be you.
I'll get on that, I promise you.
Okay.
So number two goal here, continue to grow our grassroots support. We've spent 7 years working with local activists and have hundreds of businesses and local leaders behind us. And I think, too, at some point, you have some tribal conversations as well.
Yes.
Would you like maybe that's new information? I don't want to steal any of your thunder.
Oh, no, there's no secrets. But we have 153 businesses, organizations, and support. Now, most of them are local businesses because that's where I spent like the first 2 years exclusively concentrating my energy. But, you know, now we've got like larger groups involved, and I moved to Fresno, which is not where I am now, but I moved to Fresno and like built support in Fresno as well, because that Central Valley area is very close to the proposed monument. So there's that. In terms of tribes, I've been trying to get tribal support since day one, because the first thing you do is you're looking at like who's going to be affected by this, right? And you know, tribes are really important, and obviously the past way that they have been treated is pretty horrible.
Yeah.
So you know, I don't want to be the person that's doing that again, right?
Right.
So they were my first stop. And it's, you know, we've been talking for a long time, you know, they can see that I'm still here. So, and we continue to talk. So, I mean, I have a meeting next week with one tribe, and or at least a representative from the tribe, and we'll see. I mean, you know, I mean, it's pretty hard to correct the past.
Yeah.
Right.
Right.
So, but, you know, I try to keep the door open, and I'm trying to be a better listener and not do so much talking. So that seems to help.
I think people see right away that you're authentic and sincere in your efforts. In some of my years when I was in Fresno pastoring, one of the efforts that I jumped on that was, you know, had been ongoing for some time with a lot of wonderful people organizing it was the Friends of Jesse Moro Mountain, kind of the going up towards Kings Canyon, and the Tonomi tribe. The Tonomi tribe was very key, and of course, that land being indigenous to them. How many tribes are impacted by this or have some kind of stewardship on this land, say, themselves?
Well, I mean, that's a great question. I've actually have a map, you know, and I've got all the different tribes mapped out in the area, and there's at least like 9, but there's certain ones that are sort of right in the monument area, but to say that like, you know, only those two are the ones that spent time there, it's not really, I don't think that's really realistic. I mean, the tribes moved around, right? So you've got the North Fork Mono tribe, and then there's the Miwok tribe, which is near Yosemite, and they're not federally recognized yet, but you know, that's really pretty difficult for tribes to get federally recognized at this point.
Yeah,
so there's that. But the Mono and the, and then there's Chukchansi. I mean, there's a lot of tribes. And so I've reached out to all of them, but they don't always respond back, and fair enough, you know, but I definitely have reached out to every single one that I'm aware of at this point. There's at least 9.
Well, if we do get any listeners from those tribes, our greatest respect. Yeah. And I think we could, you could do a lot, yeah, of work with Deanna. I guess, you know, along with that, these businesses that are helping rally the support and that you've been working with, people, you know, should patronize them and support businesses that have this kind of value and respect for their neighborhood,
yeah,
surrounding environment. So number, yeah, 3 was file a lawsuit to protect the,
yeah,
Pacific fisher, which we've been talking about, this, right, cute tree dweller that needs big trees and an interconnected habitat and a forestry, yes, from forestry from logging. Yeah.
Yeah.
So we've, yeah, talked about the Pacific fisher. Yeah. Somebody was, I was mentioning that we would have this conversation that the Pacific fisher was of a key interest, and somebody, yeah, doing their fast Google research, I saw that part of their diet, you know, among insects and,
yeah,
berries, also includes porcupines.
That's, the fisher is really cute, but it is a carnivore.
It's not something you can really pick up and cuddle, right? It's a wild animal.
It has a taste
for porcupine.
Well, it eats squirrels. You know, like cute little chipmunks and squirrels.
Yeah.
The fisher, that's fisher diet. So, you know, nobody likes to think of a squirrel dying, and I certainly don't. But
well, porcupine is kind of like the meal that comes with a toothpick, I imagine. You know, very.
Yes. Yeah, a porcupine is a little bit more acceptable.
Yeah.
For prey species, but the fisher is. I mean, it's definitely it's a meat eater, right? So it's,
yeah,
it's a predator. Which is kind of interesting, but the fact that it lives in trees is just, you know, and it's, yeah, it needs, you know, an interconnected, like the forest canopy has to be sort of closed over it so it's protected from predators. And so that's a good thing. That's how you keep the trees,
yeah,
in the forest from being cut down.
Right.
So
no,
yeah,
no, I'm all for the Pacific fisher. That's good. Let's,
yeah,
save that critter. Number 4, educate and train student activists in environmental,
yes,
advocacy and communications with internship programs.
Yes.
I imagine that's a life-giving experience too. To see,
yes,
these young, upcoming advocates and professional people.
They're great. I mean, we just started our internship program last year, and it is like, you know, they're teaching me, right? So I really enjoy, you know, bringing them into the process, because of course, if you've been working on something 7 years, you actually do become competent at it because you're working on it all the time. So I do have quite a bit to share. And I want them, I mean, my hope is that, you know, that I can give them an opportunity to pursue things that they're interested in, right? So it's not just, you know, what I want them to express to me what they're interested in, and then we find projects for them to work on. But I also want them to be, you know, empowered to be leaders, right? So, you know, someday, you know, they'll be teaching me for real. You know, I want them to use this as a point of growth. So I think it's been that way. I've really, it's just been, it's been a great experience, and I'm looking forward to hiring more in the future. But we're pretty close. We've been through I hired before COVID, and then they started working, and then COVID hit, and it,
yeah,
was like we had to just completely adjust everything we had planned. Like, you know, and they did great. So, you know, it's been fabulous. The other half of that is the stuff that we haven't fully invested in yet, because we haven't really started it yet because of COVID, we can't, which is taking at-risk youth up into the mountains, and they're going to learn to be leaders as well. It's just a different approach. a lot of people in the Central Valley, you know, don't have access to those parks that they live right next to. And I'm sure you're familiar with this if you were in Fresno, like there's this divide, right?
Yes, yes.
So we're working with another environmental group, a social justice group in the Central Valley. And with partnering with them, we're hoping that hopefully this coming season that we can start doing it. But we have to, you know, obviously we can't have COVID going on. So we're kind of waiting.
Can you name that group and we can give them, we can say hello to them here?
Yeah, it's CCEJN, which is the Central California Environmental Justice Network.
Yeah, no,
I think
yeah,
I got that right. They're awesome.
They are a great organization. So
yeah.
So for all the students or youth that might work with this project, share this video. Let's get the word out.
Yeah.
Well, you covered the last goal there, right? With the at-risk youth outdoor. So you got that. And then you have this enthusiastic, let's get it done. Let's get it done. It's good.
Yes.
So let me just cover, I'll put all these websites and ways to find this work online here with this video. And so, if you just plug in Deanna Lynn Wolf, you get a couple of things that pull up. You have a Wikipedia page, right, which I think is very impressive.
Yes.
Deanna, so we got that. And we have the funly.com / say the Fisher, the entire Southern Sierra Nevada. That is too long for me to spell out exactly.
Yes.
We will put this by magic of editing into this link too. And then unitetheparks.org, right? That's the website.
Right. That's the easiest one to get to. And it's also, if you click on the donate button, you'll get to the Fundly campaign. So it's just easier to go to Unite the Parks and click donate. And, you know, and it doesn't have to be, I'm happy if people reach out to me and want to participate, you know? So it's not like if you don't have very much money or you're feeling, you know, under pressure right now, you know, there are other ways to join the movement.
Yes, and share the social media, do little video vignettes like this. Get the word out. So Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, you're on all of that. TikTok, you do need little TikTok videos.
No, I'm not there yet. I mean, I'm pretty slow. I've been pretty slow to use social media Well, it's just the real amazing experiences I had were directly with people living in the area. And I felt like if you're looking to bridge a divide, you need to sit down and talk with people authentically and you can bridge it. But now obviously not someone who's, you know, really angry and has, you know, three guns or something. You're not going to bridge the divide with that person. Just forget about that.
Yeah.
But most people, if you sit down and have a heart to heart talk, you're going to learn something about them and they're going to teach you something. And then at that point, there's a chance to connect. Right. So it becomes less about what I'm saying, you know? So that's amazing. And I love that. But social media, my experience with it, with the campaign is that there's so much animosity there. I mean, everyone's aware of this now, but when I started the campaign, I had all these really authentic experiences with people, you know, on their turf, and they affected me in a good way. And then, you know, one person got a hold of the campaign and created this, a whole bunch of rumors. I mean, we're all used to this now because we see it happening at a national level, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I found that it was impossible for me to connect with these people and to unwind the rumors that happen that were just completely, you know, they were just garbage stories, right? And then you meet somebody and they already have a story for you, but your story has nothing to do with who you are, right? You know, the story's like, you know, I'm from San Francisco and I have like, you know, millions of dollars. And I'm like, that's not me. I really, you're talking about someone else. So it just, so what I'm trying to say with social media in a really long-winded way, I apologize.
No, you do.
Is that the reason I'm slow to become part of that is because, you know, I know it's important, but I don't like some of the things that it's done to society.
Yeah, right.
I think it makes it hard to connect.
I fully agree with you. In fact, you know, before shelter in place era, COVID era, I was really unplugging as much as I could and thinking about minimalism and how hard it is, especially in the Silicon Valley here. Everybody's plugged in. And I think, you know, we're looking at a thing, you know, now out of necessity, right? This is the way we can safely correspond and get some things like this done. So the great, you know, that's great innovation, the silver lining that we can work from home or we can work from mobile. There's some alarming stats that if you look at how much time you spend behind screens, you know, our younger generations are going to get past, or they're going to get to the end of their lives and they will have spent 10, 15 years behind some kind of screen device under the auspice of working or socializing. And I think that changes humanity in some way we just don't understand yet. You know, it rewires our brain, right, that we're learning about.
Well, I think you're I just was reading this article. I can't remember who it was by, but it was based in science. And, you know, it was saying that the people who are around you can influence, like, your heartbeat, basically. Yeah. Like, they can help you regulate yourself so that you're healthier.
Yes.
And so also, but they can also be, there's also, if people have a negative influence, they can also make you, you know, threaten your health, right? So the article was basically saying, yes, be around people, but be around the right people, because they can help you manage yourself and stay healthy. So we want that. But now with COVID, it's like, you can't do that. I mean, you're just in this really kind of strange world, right? So we're doing the best we can. Like, we connect over the internet, we have Zoom, and I think it's better than nothing, right?
Right.
So it's an advantage that when they had the Spanish flu, you know, over 100 years ago, right? They didn't have this, so we can at least try to make the best of it. And with social media, the positive side of that is you can try to get a good message out to people that maybe you wouldn't have necessarily connected with, right? So there are the silver linings there for sure. They're just, I mean, there's what I would prefer, which is that we, you know, we get to shake hands and give people hugs and talk to them.
Yeah. Yeah. Right.
In real time, you know?
Well, it seems like we're in this brave new world and we're trying to figure it out. But it sounds like what you're prescribing is surrounding yourself with life-giving people, right? In safe distances in nature. I think that would be a good prescription, right? Find some good positive thinkers, people that we give life to each other, we encourage each other.
Yeah.
Underneath a canopy of trees, canopy of stars. That sounds like a good prescription to me.
Yeah.
Well, Deanna, I really enjoy talking to you, and I'm excited to get this word out to other people. You know, put all the links in the places you would normally put links and the things you would normally like and subscribe and share, and also give. And when you give, for the folks that are watching this, friends and family and new friends that we're making as we do this work, when you give, put a little comment while you're giving. I think that that's a nice
That'd be great.
Thing that connects us.
So if I wanted to share this on my Facebook page, like, where would I find this? I mean, are you going to send me a link?
I'll send you the link. You'll be the first person I send the link to.
Okay.
Yeah. I'll let you send the link and you can bless it and start sharing it. And then once I know that you feel good about it, I'll start sharing it as well.
Well, I find it really difficult to watch myself. So,
me too. Yeah, I think we did a good job, though, especially as Bill Moyer and Jane Goodall. I think years from now, people might be acting out our parts.
Oh, God,
and they'll
say,
okay, I'll be Deanna, and then, you know, and they'll be doing this work.
Maybe.
And they'll be surrounded. They'll be in a world. They'll be surrounded by little Pacific fishers. And it'll be great. And we'll have plenty of trees.
Sounds good. Lots of positive people around us.
Yes. Yes. And telepathically, we'll just know we'll be in a good vibe. We'll have created utopia.
Yeah, we'll see. That's the goal, really. Create a nice space. Yes. Simple goal.
Yes.
Hard to achieve.
Heaven here on earth. You know, I think that's a part of the work. Well, Deanna, this has been, I've been looking forward to this conversation, and I hope that it's only the first of other conversations we can have, because as this campaign gains steam, I think I read somewhere that you're going to have a celebration at some point, or a...
Yes.
You have a plan.
Yeah, well, we have a musical event that's basically our online fundraiser, which is December 6th, and I can send you
Please
an invitation to that.
Yes. Hmm? Yeah, please do.
Yeah.
I did see
that. Yeah. And then sometimes it's just, you know, working on a political campaign is actually super adventurous, and you never know what's going to happen. So sometimes there's just good stories to tell, but there's so many of them that, you know, I couldn't possibly, you know, you get the highlights here, but there's lots of adventurous stories that happen when you're trying to get something like this done. It's really quite incredible.
That's right. Yeah, we need to get in front of Uncle Joe Biden and have him sign something that's important to secure this, and maybe somebody.
Well, he's announcing his cabinet, a bunch of his cabinet appointments on Tuesday. So that's going to be really something I'm going to be listening into, because those are the people we'll be reaching out to start building the connections to hopefully get them to think about the range of light. You know,
well, that's good.
Hope they're good.
You know, you ever need people to sit in those offices or be a part of those conference calls, I can put my clerical collar up and you know, be there for you too.
That would be great.
I would be more than glad to do that.
Okay. That would be awesome.
Well, Deanna, it's so fun to talk to you. You have such a bright smile and you're enthusiastic, and that's contagious. We can take a big scoop of this enthusiasm and do a lot of good work.
Yeah. Well, I do enjoy doing it. And, you know, it's actually a lot of fun. There are not good moments, but there are a lot of really fun moments too. So yeah, thank you for interviewing me and taking the time out of your day too. I really appreciate it. You're
really
such a positive person. So thank you for that.
That's
really
a real joy.
Appreciate it.
We'll talk soon. And until next time, we'll see you later.
Okay.